Nice to meet you. All clear.
When Disney's Zombies hit our screens in 2018, we couldn't get enough of the Zettison romance, the amazing songs, and equally impressive dance numbers. When the sequel was announced, it was a dream come true. In Feb 2020, Zombies 2 was released, and we met and fell in love with Willa and the werewolves. Now, we can only think of one thing. Will there be a Zombies 3? While we wait for news on Zombies 3, how about we take a trip behind the scenes and see how the Zombies movies were made? But first, a simple reminder on how to enter our brand new giveaway. We are giving away either an iPhone X Max, the new iPad mini or MacBook Pro, it's all your choice. So be sure to leave a like, comment the keyword, subscribe, and turn on notifications to enter the giveaway. It's really that simple. Let's start at the very beginning with the director who never made it to directing the movie. In 2017, Deadline announced that Zombies would be directed by the award-winning choreographer and film director Jeffrey Hornaday. It was reported that Jeffrey Hornaday would direct the film and co-choreograph it with Christopher Scott, who was announced as a choreographer. Of course, hardcore Disney fans were excited as Teen Beach Movie, a project that Christopher and Jeffrey had previously worked on together, was a testimony of the type of magic the two could make together. Between the announcement and the start of production, Jeffrey Hornaday was replaced as director by another Disney veteran, Paul Hoehn. Over the years, Paul has directed several DCOMs and Disney shows, including Let It Shine, How to Build a Better Boy, and Camp Rock 2. So we didn't have a single doubt in our minds that he would do a stellar job, but we couldn't help but wondering what happened with Jeffrey Hornaday. As far as we know, Jeffrey didn't have a falling out with Disney because shortly after getting replaced as Zombies director, he went on to direct an installment of the High School Musical movies. After seeing Zombies 1 and Zombies 2, we were pretty impressed by Paul's work. We're convinced that no one could do it better, but we are still curious. How did Hornaday go from director and co-choreographer to not even choreographing a single dance number in the film? The casting process. The actors selected to play the characters in a film can either break a movie or make a movie, as they're tasked with bringing the story to life, as well as capturing and holding the audience's attention. Filmmakers know this, and that's why they're willing to go to any length to select the perfect cast. Disney is known to hand out DCOM lead roles to prominent Disney stars, but in Zombies, things were a little bit different. Casting director Amber Horn first came across Milo Mannheim in a performance in France, and she was so impressed by his performance that she suggested that he audition for Zombies. With years of experience in theater musicals and a mother who is a Broadway actress, it's no wonder Milo was given the role after several months of relentless auditions. That's right, the audition took months because the meticulous casting team knew what they wanted and couldn't stop until they found it. One of the many things that they tested for during the casting process was chemistry between the potential actors who would play the lead roles. During Milo's sixth audition, he was paired with Meg Donnelly, who he had met and befriended at the beginning of the auditions. The pair were already smitten with each other in a best friend type of way, so it's no wonder that the casting team felt the sparks flying between them and awarded them the lead roles. We couldn't have asked for a better Zed or Addison. We don't know about you, but their on-screen chemistry gave us goosebumps. Here's a fun fact before moving on to the filming locations. None of the cast members from the 2012 Zombies and Cheerleaders movie made it into Disney's DCOM. Where? Disney's Zombies is set in the fictional town of Seabrook, where a nuclear power plant incident transformed a significant portion of the town's residents into zombies. This DCOM, just like many other Disney movies, including Camp Rock, was shot in the state of Ontario, Canada. In Toronto, to be precise. The exterior shots of the fictional Seabrook High School were filmed in Cherry Beach, Toronto. In addition to filming in Toronto, some scenes were filmed in Keith Street near Wentworth Street, north in the city of Hamilton, Ontario. For the Keith Street scenes, the street had to be properly decorated to look like a place that would fit into the fictional town of Seabrook, with green bicycles being attached to fences and purple furniture being strewn around the place. Filming for the first installation began in May 2017 and was completed in 10 weeks. During the filming period, the cast members spent all their free time hanging out together and exploring the city. So it's no surprise that when they returned to film the sequel, which was filmed between May 27 and July 15, 2019, they were already BFFs. Even the new cast members, Pierce Joza, Chandler Kinney, and Baby Ariel, who played the werewolves Willa, Wyatt, and Winter, wasted no time joining the pack. The costume. The major theme of the Zombies movie is individuality. In the movie, we see the characters learn to embrace their individuality and accept the beauty in diversity. This is why it was very important to the show's creators to emphasize on the differences between the zombies and the humans. Disney had a different vision from that of the 2012 movie. They didn't want zombies to fit in. They wanted them to stand out, and so began the hair dye experiments. In the 2012 movie, Luke Benward, who played Zed, simply had a splatter of green dye on his forehead, but Disney wanted to take things a step further further, they decided they wanted the zombies to have rainbow-colored hair. Okay, not rainbow-colored hair, per se, but brightly colored hair nonetheless. The costume and makeup department couldn't settle on a color, so Zed spent quite a lot of time in the makeup chair going through one bottle of hair dye after another. They tried a mixture of bluish teal, green, and yellow tips, but that didn't do so well for them. They tried a couple more dyes, which didn't work either. Eventually, they settled for the cool dark green hair that Zed and the rest of the zombies sport in the movie. Speaking of hair, in an interview, Meg revealed that she had to wear a wig of her own hair. While it had been decided that her character would have white hair, the costume department hadn't decided on a style, which means that she had to go through a lot of wig testing. In the movie, for the most part, she wore a wig to hide her white hair. This means she also had to undergo a lot of wig testing for the cover-up wig. After trying out several colors, it was decided that her natural hair color was the best choice. Still, it had to look like a wig, so they made a wig of her own hair. Anyway, back to the zombies. The good thing about playing an undead character or a supernatural character in a movie like zombies is that you get to spice up your costume. The actors who played zombies and werewolves were allowed to artistically express themselves through their costumes. Zed expressed his love for football in his costume, and Willa got a leg wrap as a symbol of her position. The not-so-fun part of being undead is that you have to spend hours in a costume trailer. Milo told 17 Magazine that it took him roughly 2 hours to complete his makeup routine and another half hour to get it off. He said that all the actors who played humans would have been in and out of the trailer by then. Sorry, Zed, these things don't come easy. Special effects, stunts, and stunt doubles. If there's one thing that all werewolves have in common, it's glowing eyes, and the zombies' werewolves are no different. In the movie, we see their eyes glow every once in a while. How did the filmmakers achieve this? Easy. In today's world, CGI is a filmmaker's best friend. Before now, actors would have to wear contact lenses to film the glowing eye scenes, but Disney decided not to put its actors through that hassle. Instead, they added glowing eyes using CGI. Moving on to the topic of stunt doubles, Milo, who was a pretty decent footballer before he took on the role of Zed, only uses a stunt double when he's being destroyed or tackled. Meg, on the other hand, had no cheerleading experience prior to her role as Addison, but she quickly got a hang of it. A Toronto cheerleading team was hired, and their coach was also on set to help actors and cheerleaders get in sync with each other. Also, all characters underwent a month of dance rehearsals before production actually began, and in that time, Meg learned all she needed to and became so good at cheerleading that she only used a stunt double once. The only time Addison was played by a cheer double and not by Meg, for safety reasons, was when she was tossed up in the air doing the twist before Zed caught her. Before we call it a day, here is one last secret that'll blow your mind. Ever wonder how the cast could execute such flawless backflips and stunts in the BAM dance number? The secret behind their extremely fluid movement is a trampoline. Crazy, right? We know! The day before the scene was filmed, the choreographer saw Milo messing around and doing a couple of backflips on a trampoline-like device that the actors had on set. He got inspired. The next day, he brought in a 30-foot by 10-foot trampoline for the cast and re-choreographed the routine. The super cool trampoline, combined with Addison's idea to sing the track at double speed, made it look like everything else was in slow motion. This birthed the fire dance number that we now know as BAM. And with that last secret, we have come to the end of today's episode. There you have it, ladies and gentlemen, all the behind-the-scenes secrets of Disney's 104th DCOM. Feel free to share your thoughts in the comment section. Till next time, goodbye, and thanks for watching. But first, a simple reminder on how to enter our brand new giveaway. We are giving away either an iPhone X Max, the new iPad Mini, or MacBook Pro. It's all your choice. So be sure to leave a like, comment the keyword, subscribe, and turn on notifications to enter the giveaway. It's really that simple.